Welcome to the Kent Clasby Show. Today with me I have Mark Carey and my Ed McMahon, Tom Clasby.
You're Ed McMahon, thank you. Before you begin, you tell me what the baseball hat's all about?
So, this is my baseball cap I got yesterday, just before my first game of the season. We won the game 10-3, so that's
10-3.
Pretty good.
You were on base a couple times.
Yeah, I didn't hit because the pitchers never gave me something to hit, so.
Good. Wait for the right pitch, that's what I say.
Good eye.
Good eye.
I have a couple questions to ask you. Were you born in Quincy?
I was not born in Quincy. I was born in, I was all over the place before. We did it backwards. Mostly Quincy moved down to the South Shore. I was born in Somerville. My parents were from Medford. My mom and my dad was from South Boston. But I was born in Somerville Hospital and grew up in Scituate. And then when I was a little kid, moved to Maine for a couple of years. And then from there, I went to, we came to Quincy. So I was 11 years old when I moved here. So I've been here most of my life, which has been great. It's a great place to grow up.
Scituate, he must be an aristocrat. Anyway.
See, yeah, most people go from Quincy to Scituate. The Irish Riviera, as they used to call it. I'm not sure your Ed McMahon's working out so well. You might have a solo gig ahead of you. So.
So another question is, what do you like to do?
Well, I like to do a lot of different things, Kent. I've always been involved in the creative world, you know. So I'm a musician. I'm a filmmaker. I love my day job working as the media director for Mayor Tom Koch in the City of Quincy. I've done a lot of different things in my life, which I'm very grateful that I've been able to secure these jobs. I was a singer for many, many years. I still am. And I had a band called Dick and Jane for my most recent project, which we're playing this year at a few festivals. And then I used to sing at the Common Market when I was a kid, when I was younger, for years. And that's where your dad and I have known each other since we were kids. We started out in the choir in high school. So I was the only one that could drive. So I would drive your grandparents' car around this little Volkswagen Beetle, and I could drive, and he couldn't. So I've known your dad since we were kids. He was one of my first friends when I moved here in Quincy.
Yeah, pretty cool.
But I'm a musician. I played in a lot of different bands, and I play at church, you know, and different things like that still. And a couple of years ago, made my first movie. So I've done a few short films and like to work with the folks here at QATV. They're fantastic. And whenever I've been able to work at this place, and we encourage anyone to come here and volunteer if you want to know anything about the media and broadcast industry. But I was in radio for 20 years as well. Most recently we made a movie called Sweeney Killing Sweeney. It's a comedy. So I'm a producer on it. And my creative partner, Lisa Amola, who's the communications director for the city, we took some time off and we made a movie. It was a comedy. It's really funny. So a lot of Boston comedians like Steve Sweeney, Lenny Clark, Stephen Wright, Nick DiPaolo, Bobby Slayton, all these guys were all in the movie. You would know who they are. Your dad would know, and other folks might know who they are. Much like Ed McMahon, wink, wink. So,
and when he's 18, he can watch it.
When you're 18, you can watch it, exactly. It's a funny movie. It's a funny movie. So it comes out on iTunes in the end of April. But it was a real blast to be the music. I was the assistant director. Lisa was the director. We're both producers on the film. And I was the music supervisor on it as well. And we went to Los Angeles a few weeks ago. And we got to be on the Joe Rogan show with Steve Sweeney. Steve Sweeney was the star of the film. So Joe Rogan's one of the biggest podcasts in the world. And then we got to have a premiere in Beverly Hills. So we took meetings with distributors as well. And Peter Farrelly, who just won the Oscar for Best Picture and Best Screenplay, was there with our film. He hung out with us afterwards. He loved the movie. Bobcat Goldthwait, another comedian, a couple of producers from TV shows. It was fun. It was a good time.
I hear you do some stuff with drones. And
I do. No one's ever asked me that way. But yes, I do.
I have a drone at home, and it isn't the best drone, but I like to hear about what kind of drone you use and what you use it for.
Sure. I use the drone primarily for film, for shooting. So the cool thing about the drone, and you know it just as well as I do because you have one, they're really, really fun.
Yeah.
So I think I use it for filming. So you have to have two different ways of being able to operate it. First of all, let's talk about the owning a drone first. So this, mm-hmm. the one I have is the Phantom 4.
Oh yes,
which is a little bit older, but it's a great. It's a nice
DJI.
Nice drone. So they're heavy with the battery in it. So you have to be really careful. You also have to be FAA certified. So from the Federal Aviation Administration, you have to get a license to be able to fly it. So I do it for a lot of city work and for some shots that on the mayor's show we're coming back doing again. So I'll get like some beautiful cinematic views of Quincy that you usually would have to get a helicopter with a big camera to shoot these beautiful cinematic shots. But now you can use a drone, mm-hmm. and it looks just as amazing. It's 4K film. But mm-hmm. so the cool thing is, as you know, if you're a gamer, if you like to video, you have to be able to operate the drone, mm-hmm. and then you have to be able to understand how to frame a shot for like a film or a movie or whatever. So I've been able to use my drone in music videos. I've used it. We've rented other drones to do some higher end filming, and I mostly use this drone for city work. So. It's been pretty cool. It's fun to operate, but I've got it now where I think I can. I've never dropped it in the water.
That's good.
Which is really good, right? But most people who use their drones professionally end up losing their first drone or their first couple, and we haven't lost it yet. So I use it a lot.
Going back to music, and really, music's been in his blood for a long time. And I was telling you, people that you wouldn't remember, but I think a lot of the audience would remember the people that. Yeah, she worked with it. Maybe you want to hear a little bit about that.
That's a good idea.
Yeah, so let's do that. Let's talk like about. So I come from a musical family. So my grandfather was a piano player. He was a jazz piano player. And my grandmother was a singer. So my grandmother was a singer. So that was really kind of cool. My uncle is still. He's like 80 years old, and he sounds like a cross between Frank Sinatra and Vic Damone. Two famous musicians from a long time ago, and he's really really good. So my dad was a singer, but my grandmother traveled the country with some big bands and some famous musicians, and Sid Caesar and Imogene Coca. A lot of the audience might know who she is, as well as she was friends with Jackie Gleason. She toured with him a little bit. Tommy Dorsey, some of the really big bands. Liberace was her piano player for a little while. So she was out there, and then she played all the big clubs in Boston. But she went all over the country and toured with Henny Youngman also. Henny Youngman, he's a famous comedian that if most young people would know from Goodfellas or something like that. But his famous line was, "Take my wife, please." You ever hear that one?
No.
Not that funny, is it? But if you hear them one after the other, they're pretty funny. So I had an experience with Henny Youngman once where he was known as the king of the one-liners. He was a really famous comedian in like the 40s, before my time, before your dad's time, really old we're talking. So he was, but he was a good friend of my grandmother's. So I always said if I ever met one of these people that she ever worked with, because I'm a musician, and I always wanted her to talk about those years, and it was so far behind her, she just didn't want to talk about it anymore. So I found out Henny Youngman was playing in Boston. So I went to go see him. He was in a lot of movies, and I was a very famous comedian. So I went to go see him at some club in Boston, and he was really, really funny. Who thinks, you know, take my wife, please, that's funny? Well, one after the other, he starts telling all these jokes, and you start laughing, and it starts to swell and swell, and you laugh a lot more. So I thought he was really funny. Anyway, after the show was over, I barreled my way through the crowd, and everybody wants to meet him, and I got to meet him. And I said, "Hey, you used to work with my grandmother." He goes, "Yeah, who's that kid?" And he said, I said, "Ruth Carey was her name at the time." And he said, "You're kidding me. She's still alive?" And I said, yeah, she's still alive. So he took me backstage, and he called my grandmother, and she wasn't home. So he called her every time he came into Boston and tried to take her out for lunch. And she's like, "You know, geez, Henny, I got a lot to do." And I'm like, "Mom, Grandma, Nana, take me to meet Henny Youngman." But no, so she knew a lot of famous people, and I got it from her, and it was just an interesting life that she had. My middle name is named after a friend of hers, Joe Dineen, because he was very close with my grandmother and my father. So Joe Dineen was a famous writer. He wrote Purple Shamrock and a lot of great books, and he was a Boston Globe famed reporter. Yep. But wrote a lot of books, national books, and he was very close with my grandmother and my father. And my father gave me his. He was like a father figure to him. So my middle name, Joseph, Mark Joseph Carey, is named after Joe Dineen. So that's my story, and I'm sticking to it. Tell me more about that hat.
I was just going to say she was fascinating, your grandmother. And Henny Youngman, he always said that was his favorite joke, take my wife, please. But I think my favorite joke that he used to tell is my wife fell on the wishing well. I didn't know they worked. That was one of his. But that's what he would do, the one-liners. You know what? We did talk a little bit about the hat. But, you know, one of the things you've been doing, Kenty, maybe Mark would find this interesting.
Swimming.
No.
My grandmother is from Japan, and my mother made a deal with me if I learned to speak Japanese in a year, because we're going to Japan, or we may go to Japan in April with her, if I learn Japanese. So I'm working hard at it.
Good for you. Do you know any Japanese words?
Well, I know a couple more, not much more than I did in my first episode on this.
Yeah. Like arigato.
Yeah.
Arigato or konnichiwa. Konnichiwa.
Konnichiwa.
Konnichiwa. Do itashimashi. I don't know. This is one that is quite different, but I know asake, which is alcohol.
Oh boy.
That's just, well, good job, Epic Man. Anyway, so that's really great. That's great. My niece speaks Chinese fluently. She studied it in college, and she's going to study it more as she goes off and to get her master's degree. But that's great to learn another language like that, especially one that's so close, because your mom is half Japanese and your grandmother is. That's wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's great. Good
for
you.
It's a great language to know for business and for. I mean, it would be very, very valuable, worth learning for sure. But what interested you? Was it just that Obachan, which is what? Obachan?
Yeah, I mean, she definitely got me into
but
it.
Tell them what Obachan means, because they don't
Obachan is grandma in Japanese.
Okay.
And my Obachan, she got me into it. I never would have wanted to learn Japanese if it wasn't for her. Because now that I think about it, I might work with Nintendo or something like that if I could get good grades and be successful in college if I go, or anything like that, and then go to Japan and get a nice job.
Oh, nice. Make sure you come back and visit every once in a while.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
So that's a trip that's possibly planned for next year, and who's going?
So the possible trip that will be is planned is I may go, my dad may go, and my mom may go, and then my Obachan, my Auntie Flo, and Uncle Jim, and my Auntie Jenna, and my Uncle John, and almost all my cousins.
So just a couple people.
Almost all your cousins, too. So there's 20 cousins.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. I did not know that everyone was going. That's
well,
interesting.
Well, not everyone.
A lot of them are, though, huh?
A lot of them, and that's a lot
that's
of money.
And Auntie Flo's from where?
France.
Auntie Flo's from France. So yeah. It's kind of funny when we hear Auntie Flo and Obachan speak together. And I'm not making fun of them, because they both are bilingual, but it is funny with the different accents. They're both speaking English, but one's in a Japanese accent and the other is in a French accent.
Oh, that's great.
And they're both very, very proficient.
Makes for a great multicultural family. That's fantastic. Yeah.
And now I'm learning how to play the piano, and it's hard, but I'm getting somewhere. And I have a couple of cousins that are good at it, but one in particular is very good at it. He can play a lot.
Really?
He can play Beethoven's Fifth and Seventh and Moonlight Sonata for Elise. And,
great.
Military Polonaise or whatever it's called by Chopin, and he can do all sorts of songs, and he's 16, so.
That's amazing.
Who's your favorite classical?
I like Beethoven.
I do too.
And Chopin.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm a Beethoven, Mozart, two of my favorite, yeah. But I like Chopin as well. That's great that you like. I didn't even discover classical music till I was later in life.
Yeah, I get that from my grandma because that's all she listens to. And
And your mother's father.
Yeah.
Your grandfather, who we didn't know, was a concert pianist.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he played all those, particularly my understanding is from Mummy that he loved Chopin. She got a kick out of you liking Beethoven because she said her father did not care for Beethoven. So it is interesting that
My Obachan loves Beethoven.
Does she? Obachan loves Beethoven?
But she didn't like Beethoven because, I never got to meet him, so I wouldn't know. But this is what my mom said, that he doesn't like how the song repeats itself, but almost all songs repeats itself, but I guess Chopin does different.
Does less of it?
Yeah, less of it.
Yeah.
So.
Interesting.
Now, here's a word I'm going to teach you. I'm a hack. I can play piano, drums, and guitar, mostly guitar, but I can't really. I learned all about on my own, so I call myself a hack. It's because I can't read music, which is the way to learn is to read the music, because you can play those beautiful classical pieces as I've sort of chopped them up a little bit, but that's really cool.
It's great to have both, though, because you are learning how to read, and that's, I agree, I mean, that's really important, but
read notes. I thought you meant read.
Yes, you can already read.
Books.
That's good. Yeah.
Yeah.
But your uncles pretty much play by ear, and they play beautifully.
Yes.
You know, I don't think does Uncle Joe read?
Uncle Joe can play by ear, which is absolutely.
Yeah, and he plays.
It's
amazing.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I play by ear too.
Yeah.
But it's in what's great. I wish I took the lessons because one of if you can play by ear, you automatically have that. Sort of that's born within you, I think. I don't think that people can learn to play by ear. I think you either can or you can't. But when you can take the actual technical skills of learning how to play a piano or a guitar, violin, whatever it may be, and then you can add that extra listening piece, because when people say play by ear, it means that you can hear it and repeat it and put it in your own and put it in yourself. So I can hear it and I can repeat it, but if I had the technical skills a little bit more, I'd be better. So it's great to have both. It really is. That's where I think that a lot of the other people may thrive, when they have both both the technical skills and the learning ability, the reading ability, and the natural born talent.
Now you have a recital coming up, don't you?
Yes, I have a recital coming up, and he has an odd way of preparing for that. I mean, it's a great way, but it's an odd way.
How?
So
underwater.
At a circus. No, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Well, it's kind of like at a circus.
Okay, really? Do tell.
So, I play my recital piece, and he's taken paper, and he's blown it in my face, rattling keys, because that's what the people in the audience will be doing.
Wow.
And he
that's
wants
great.
Me to get used to it, and then they'll start, like, fake coughing and sneezing and yelling and... It makes baby crying noises, and it's
If somebody starts yelling at your recital, stop playing and say, stop, and then go back. No, I'm kidding. Yeah. Don't do that. Don't do that.
That's pretty cool. And the pieces that you're learning are contemporary pieces. They're not classical, or are they?
Well, not yet. Yeah. They're not, like...
Yeah. A couple of cool pieces. One of them, I think, your instructor's dad wrote. Is that right?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's
that's kind of cool.
You couldn't find it on YouTube or anything, which is sad. But it's called Beginning Rock in High School Rock.
Yeah.
So it's like learning the rock version of piano, I guess.
Yeah.
And you do like a lot of different types of music. You're not just classical music. You like...
Yeah, I like all sorts of
different... What are we playing in the car a lot?
The Eagles.
The Eagles, yeah. I like the Eagles.
I listen to the Eagles a lot, and I like a lot of their hits. Most of their hits.
Yeah, it's funny, you know, I think we talked about it, and I like a lot of their hits too, but the ones that aren't hits, I don't tend to care for as much. Like a lot of times when you buy an album, there's a hit song on it, and then you learn to love the whole album. I seem to, with the Eagles, just stick to the hits.
Yeah, same with me.
Yeah, I wouldn't be their biggest fan. I think that they were good, but I mean, I like a lot of other musicians, but it's funny, this morning I listened to a lot of music done, musical scores, like Hans Zimmer. So I love Hans Zimmer has they're very emotionally driven songs. So if you ever get a chance to listen to Hans Zimmer, He's really, really good. It's very powerful music. Classical, like, but it's got sort of an emotional feel to it, so I listen to a lot of that. Then I'll listen to rock and rap and, you know,
yeah,
religious and everything else. I listen to it all.
Yeah. I have a guitar, and I know both of you play guitar. And
I'm a lot better than he is, though.
I don't know.
I'm just gonna.
He's the one playing at the.
I'm gonna stay quiet on this one point. Go ahead, Kent. I'm sorry to interrupt.
I'll be interrupted.
I'll concede he's a real pro, and I'm just learning.
Well, I mean, you're good. You're good. You practice a lot. You practice a lot, especially
yep.
when
That's
I'm
great.
Doing something I need to hear.
Keep practicing it.
So you have a guitar, too?
Yes, I have a guitar, but I don't use it, and I have a ukulele, and I don't use it, and I have a couple harmonicas, and I could learn how to use it because I don't want to put it to waste and get better and learn to play more instruments.
Of all the, two instruments, ukulele or guitar, don't learn ukulele first. You learn guitar first.
Yeah.
Because it's the best to learn that. Then you can play ukulele a lot easier. Mm-hmm. But if you learn how to play guitar first, when you decide to pick it up, if you do, you want to play guitar first. Harmonica is really fun. I can play harmonica too. That's a really fun instrument.
What reminds me, there's a certain note on the harmonica, and I can play it over and over again just because it sounds like a truck going by, and I like it.
A what?
Like a truck.
Oh, yeah,
honking.
Cool.
I don't know why.
Oh, yeah, honking. Yeah, I can.
That's cool.
I can get that. Yeah.
Some people say that your dad's playing sounds like a truck going
sounds
by.
Like, it sounds like two cats fighting, I think.
Of course I'm kidding. You
know. Well, we used to have two cats that were fighting.
We did, yes. Mm-hmm. We have lots of animals, don't we?
Yes.
Yes, we do. Well, you know what, Kinty? I'm looking at the clock, and I think I don't know exactly what time it is, but
maybe we should start introducing the Senior Olympics.
Well, we can just mention the Senior Olympics. We're going to do a PSA on the Senior Olympics too, but we should encourage people if they want to come out, they can contact us at 617-376-1506. You've watched the, just give us a little bit of your reflections as you've seen the seniors, because you've come to work on days off and whatnot, and about their athletic ability.
Well, I'm going to make this quicker because of our time we have. And, well, on the first episode, we kind of went over all of that, and the seniors are very good at whatever sport they want to play. They have pickleball, which I never heard of before, but it's amazing. They're better than me or maybe some kids 16 or so. It's incredible. And their volleyball, it's amazing. And that's
pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
That's pretty cool.
All right, buddy. Well, I think this has been another fun-filled show. I'm going to take over my role as sidekick and say to everyone out there, we really appreciate you tuning in to the
Kent Clasby Show.
We'll see you next time.
Thanks, Kent. Thanks, Ed.
No problem.